Hello. Welcome to my stream. I am here to take a journey of the mind back to the year 1984. The Apple computer has taken the world by storm. And the model that you were looking at here on the screen is the model that I had, the Apple IIc. It's basically just an Apple IIe. But compressed into a smaller case, and it doesn't have as much expandability as the 2E did. It was intended as more of an all-in-one kind of package. Hey, Xenoc, welcome. Thanks for hanging out. And the 2C wasn't super successful, but it was the model that I owned, so I have a special place in my heart for it. Of course, I wasn't even alive in 1984. I didn't have my Apple IIc. 97 was not the prime of the Apple II lifespan. Although it was surprisingly less difficult than you would think to find like replacement parts and people selling old games and stuff. I remember we had a catalog that had a bunch of Apple II stuff that you could send away for, mail order. But the bulk of my experience with the Apple II was a huge box of pirated software. And I had a Genesis at the time, which was my main video game system. This was after my Nintendo blew up and we got rid of all my Nintendo games. So, I had my Genesis, but you only got new Genesis games every once in a while. They were still full price. And, I only got them on special occasions, Christmas, my birthday, and, a couple new games a year. It's not enough to keep you entertained. So, once we got the Apple IIc with a huge box of pirated software, I had a world of experiences at my fingertips. And with Apple Basic, the promise of making my own games was also a big draw. And of course, it was not, it was not the kind of computer it was cool to have in 1997. Everyone made fun of me because I couldn't go online with it. It wasn't a quote unquote real computer, but it was still pretty formative to my early video game / computer experience. And I wanted to share some of those experiences with you today. So without further ado, let us boot into just a blank disk here, just a blank master disk. And so for some reason, the Apple emulator I'm using, OBS thinks that it's constantly making noise. I don't hear any noise, and I assume you don't either, but let me know if anything sounds weird to you during the stream. I'm using Apple Win, and I'm emulating, it says Enhanced Apple IIe Emulation. It's essentially the same as Apple II. And to start things off, we have this brand new Apple IIc computer because it's 1984. But how the heck do you use the darn thing? It's 1984. I don't know how to use computers. Well, luckily, there was a smorgasbord of introductory educational software included with the system, and I had all that stuff, along with all the pirated stuff. This was genuine. It had the manuals and everything. So let's take a quick look at how to use the Apple IIc. I'm using enhanced disk speeds. Let me know if this is too loud. It doesn't look too loud on my end, but again, it's hard to tell. So we have a digital representation of Apple IIc. keyboard down there. With this dank intro. So the big draw of the 2C, other than its ease of use, is its quote-unquote portability. It was technically more portable than any other Apple computer at the time. It had a carrying handle, and it had, you know, it was fairly small. I'd estimate it probably weighed about 10 to 15 pounds, so something you could carry around with you. But it didn't have a battery, it wasn't like a laptop by any means. There were laptops available at the time, very early ones. But I think the idea was you can carry the computer with you back and forth from home to work, plug it into, you have one monitor at work and one monitor at home, just, you know, take it with you. Of course, you would have to bring the power supply with you too, which was an additional. This is a picture of the Apple keyboard. Please find the key marked return on the keyboard and press it now. You can use the key marked escape if you've used this program before. So if you sit here for a minute, it will eventually just restart the whole thing. I'm going to flash return at you. Please press the key marked return. So I suppose this was for people, resellers and retailers who had the Apple IIc set up in their shop or whatever, and were just running this demonstration software on it, and it would just kind of repeat, like in attract mode or something. Can I skip that? Okay, cool. Good! You found the return key! Remember this. The program was intended for adults and children, but adults as well. Let's do it again. When you finish reading this, please press the key marked return to continue. Great. Now you know that you press the return key whenever you are finished reading something. You've got the idea. In general, remember this. Remember this rule. When in doubt, press return. This lets the Apple know that you're ready to proceed. The Apple. Take another look at the keyboard. It looks like a typewriter keyboard with some extra keys, but it's much more versatile and easy to use. My mic is going in and out. Oh, it's probably the noise gate. Sorry about that. Let me just disable that for now. I adjusted some of the settings on my microphone, so the noise gate is probably not where it needs to be. When the Apple wants you to type something, it will display a cursor, which shows where you will begin typing. Here is a cursor. Please press return to find out more about this blinking bar cursor. Use the Apple keyboard to answer yes to the question below. No help from the audience, please. You hear that, Zenok? You better not help out with this. Are you using an Apple computer now? Please press the Y key. Please press the E key. Won't just let you type in Y. You have to type in the whole word. Also, you might notice that I am typing in capital letters, which is the default, sort of. I believe the original Apple II and the Apple II Plus didn't support lowercase letters at all. I don't think it was until the Apple IIe that lowercase letters were even a thing. So you see, you type answers just as you would on a typewriter, and you press the return key to tell the Apple, I'm finished typing my response, it's your turn now. One of the first things you'll notice when typing on the Apple keyboard is that you can make the keys automatically repeat if you leave your finger on the key. To try this next, please press return. Go ahead and press a key with a letter on it. Practice repeating the letter by holding down the key. Computer practice. Yep, that's repeating all right. Also, the key buffer is way longer than you would think. Like, let's try holding the A key down for like 2 seconds and see. Well, let's try a second. All right. 1/1000. Yeah, so it stores a lot of key presses. Whether you're typing one letter at a time or repeating letters, your fingers can sometimes slip. This leads to the question, press return to see the question. What if you make a mistake? Don't panic. If you make a typing error, you can use this key, called the delete key, to correct the error. It's called the delete key because it has delete written on it, and that's what it does. The delete key backs up and deletes a character. Press return to see how it works. What fruit is named after a computer? Oh, Apple, y'all are so cheeky. Let's correct the answer above to read apple instead of apple. Please press the delete key. The cursor will back up and delete the F in slow motion. Whoa. Now correct this error by pressing the E key. Apple is a neat word, but we were thinking of apple instead. Press the delete key to delete the G. You finished this correction, so press return. Good. Now please press return to try another example. Every child loves to play with a dolt. Let's try correcting the word dolt to read doll. Yeah. You finished this correction. Very good. As you see, delete always deletes to the left, which makes it useful for erasing errors at the end of a word. Sometimes an error will not be at the end of a word. When this happens, you use these keys, called left arrow and right arrow, to move the cursor next to the error. The left arrow key moves the cursor backwards, the right arrow key moves the cursor forwards. Press return to try correcting an error that isn't at the end of a word. An error is like a brick wall in the middle of this word. First use the left arrow to back up until you are next to the error. Start by pressing the left arrow key. Now interestingly, the Apple operating system doesn't work like this at all. The instructions it's giving you are basically only in, they're only applicable to like word processing software and stuff. Hey Jane, welcome. Which is kind of funny. I'll show what happens when you press delete in the main OS in a little bit. Ooh, sound effects. Only delete can knock down a brick wall. Left arrow backs up, but has no power to erase. You finish this correction. Very good. Who is buried in Grant's tomb? Superb! A real live error. Romeo learned to be locked in the heart of... Hint, the cursor must be to the right of the letter O, the brick wall, so that delete can erase it. Oh man. I have a microphone pot filter blocking my keyboard, so apologies for any... There we go. You seem to be having some trouble with this. Please press return and we'll go through it step by step. So yeah. Only Apple approved jokes are allowed. You are doing very well. Right, it's showing the power of the computer, you know, doing something you can't do on a typewriter. Expanding the paper. No matter where the cursor is, pressing return accepts the entire answer. Also untrue for DOS or whatever it's called. There was ProDOS, and then there was another kind of DOS. I think DOS 3.3 is the one that I'm the most familiar with. As we mentioned before, a computer is more versatile than a typewriter. For example, a computer can ask you, what's your first name? Hey, don't capitalize my name, you jerk. No. M-A-T-T. No capital letter. Thank you. Yes? Oh, it won't let me type more than that. Sometimes a program lets you choose what you want to do, just as a restaurant lets you choose your meal. Press return to see today's menu. To choose a meal, type a number from 1 to 11 and then press return. Not fresh today. Well, the idea of eating not fresh escargots is a little unappealing. Let's try the secret menu item. Nope, doesn't work. Okay, I'll go with today's special, chicken fried steak. An excellent selection. American cuisine is so tasty. I disagree. Please press return when you finish eating. LOL. This entire program is also listed on a menu, which we will show you next. You may go through the topics in order, or you may investigate on your own. Please press return to reveal this program's main menu. So yeah, I'm not going to go through the whole thing. Just holding your hand through basic computer knowledge. I just wanted to show off what they thought of people back in 1984 who were learning to use a computer for the first time. What friendly advice do you have? As you can see, using a computer isn't so difficult after all. Press return to find out why some programs are especially easy to use. A program that gives clear instructions and responds reasonably if you make a typing error is called friendly. Such programs are easy to use. Try making mistakes on purpose to see how a friendly question handles errors. Ooh. It's letting us think outside the box. Type a number from 1 to 4, okay. F-O-U... let's try... O-N-E. Please try again using only digits. Oh, that's very friendly of them. 6 is too large. Please try again. Please try again using only digits. Oh yeah, very friendly. 0 is too small. Please try again. Thank you. At the other end of the scale are the unfriendly programs. They give unclear instructions and don't tell you how to correct your errors. Here is an extreme example of a very unfriendly question. Input the number. Dang. Yeah, pretty disgusting. Of course, no program can be perfectly friendly, much less perfect, but good programs make an effort to cooperate with you in getting your job done. Remember our attempt to capitalize your first name? That was an example. Yeah, I do remember that. That was an example of this program making a sterling effort to help you. But, well, I didn't want you to help me. I typed my name lowercase for a reason. But what if a program seems bent on fighting you? Check your typing. Everyone makes mistakes occasionally. Lock the caps lock key down. Many programs require you to type everything in capital letters. Check the program manual, RTFM. Seek help from someone who knows how the program works. Wow. If things can change from one program to the next, how can you figure out what to do? Always read the program's manual and follow instructions displayed on the screen. Press escape to proceed. Oh well, let's pretend I wasn't paying attention and just press enter. Let's try it again. Please read the instructions above carefully. Wow. Good. Sorry for the sneaky trick, but the point about reading the instructions really is important. So there's menu item 11 is like a quiz, quizzing you on your knowledge of the game, or not the game, everything that it goes over with you. I don't think I'm going to go through all that. Anything else interesting here? Let's try number 7. There are some keys that don't do anything when you press them by themselves. Instead, they are used to make other keys work differently. The key marked Control is one of these special keys. It does nothing when you press it all by itself, but when you use Control with another key, the combination will do something different. Hold down the Control key with one finger and press the G key with another finger. It gives you a beep. If you would like to hear the beep again, go ahead and hold Control and press G as much as you like or until it disturbs the neighbors. Yeah. Control key is used with other keys. There are two other keys that are sometimes used, the Open Apple and Solid Apple. Now, when I was a kid, I always said Open Apple and Closed Apple because open is the opposite of closed, which makes sense. I would probably also accept, I don't know, what's the opposite of salad? What's the opposite of solid in this case? Hollow? Solid and hollow? I don't know. Open and closed is just what made sense to me. The open apple key is to the left of the spacebar. It has the outline of the apple symbol. The solid apple key is to the right of the spacebar. Oh boy, it's time for a fun game. So these apple keys are also, actually, they are duplicates of the two joystick buttons as well. So instead of using the keys, which on the emulator is the left alt and the right alt, I'm going to use my Xbox 360 controller here to play this awesome apple sorting game. Hopefully it is correctly configured. Press open apple as soon as you see, yeah. Oh, it's not configured at all. Let me try to fix this real quick. Here we go. Yeah. It's just time to sort some apples. Oops, I missed one. Oops, I missed another one. This game's hard. Jobs on the phone. Look at how you can almost completely stop the apple just by. Hey, I got one! Oh, it didn't give me my score. I guess I did so badly at it. Oh wait, it's going to. Hold down the open apple key and press the question mark key to see how you did sorting apples. Also, I think this is just a straight up lie. Many programs give you information or help when you press open apple question mark. I don't think I've ever used a program that actually does that. You sorted 4 apples correctly. Not bad for a day's work. Yeah, I don't want to go through all this just to do the quiz. We hope you've enjoyed using this program and will return soon. You may wish to jot down the numbers of these topics for your next visit. Please take the disk out of the disk drive and put it back in its envelope. You can now return the printed part. Return to the printed part of the interactive guide. Oh yeah, I forgot that the manual had like, you know, use this disk at this time. So you were like reading along with the manual. Hey Tarka, welcome. Or you were like playing, you know, using disks when the manual told you to. Also, open apple control reset is the Apple IIc equivalent of control alt delete. Here's another disk that came with the Apple IIc. Some audio is popping every 3 seconds. It might be the emulator. OBS is reacting very strangely to the emulator, and I don't know why. Is it, like, unbearable? Is it so annoying that it makes the video unwatchable? later and I don't know why. Is it like unbearable? Is it so annoying that it makes the video unwatchable?
I don't really hear it on my end. Xenox says it's not unbearable. Okay. So here's another disc that came with the computer. This is the Apple at Play. And it also came with the Apple at Work, which is just a, you know, a guide to using word processors and stuff. Look at how crisp everything is. This is because it's actually running in text mode now. Everything that the previous disc did was in high resolution graphics mode, and the Apple II had very weird color. I don't even know what to call it. Like, the way it handled color was just bizarre, and it makes all of the letters tinged with like pink or green, and it looks very strange. This disc was created for your enjoyment. Oh, thank you. It is a collection of games and activities that test your quickness, luck, and learning. Before you begin, you should know a couple of things about the disc. First, since some of these programs only understand uppercase, be sure you lock down all the caps lock. Well, lock down the caps lock key to get all caps. Yes, lock it down. Since each program is different, you'll find that you'll do something different to quit or leave the game. Sometimes you'll select an option from a menu to end. Other times, you may have to restart the computer with Open Apple Control Reset. This reminds me of, like, demo discs in the PlayStation and Xbox era. They're like, every demo, you know, make sure you read the instructions so you know how to quit. Sometimes you might have to reset the console. Same thing. The Quick Quiz is not exactly a game. It lets you check your understanding of the material covered in this interactive guide. Oh, now we get to have fun. Alright, Apple 21. Old Las Vegas Blackjack. Nothing like teaching your kids to gamble at an early age. Number of players, 0. Oh. It just resets. I thought it would have the computer play against itself. Alright, number of players, 1. $5 table, of course, since we're high rollers. Oh, it does this press A to add a new player thing every single hand, just in case you want to add more players. Yeah, you always start off with no money, so you have to get a loan. Let's see, I think I will wager 1,000. All right. Dang it. Want to change tables? No. All right, 500. All right, 13. Clear case of, you know, you should hit on a 13. What? Oh, that was bogus. I had no way of winning that. It's almost like the house always wins in the end. Alright, 500. Alright, 12. Yeah, definitely hit on a 12. 16. I hate 16s. Once again, no way to win. Man, blackjack is BS. I hate this game. No. You're down $1,000. Goodbye. I don't know why this is on here. Financial tools. This should have been on the Apple at Work disc. Salvage value. Well, that was fun. Oops. let's end this program. Oh, this came out in 1984? Really? I feel like this was another one of those games, along with Oregon Trail, that everyone played in school at some point. Everyone in the U.S., I mean, of course. People outside the U.S., their experiences are going to be very different than mine. Welcome to Lemonsville, California. In this small town, you are in charge of running your own lemonade stand. You can compete with as many other people as you wish, but how much profit you make is up to you. The other stand's sales will not affect your business in any way. If you make the most money, you're the winner. Man, look at how the text is perfectly justified, but there also aren't any extra spaces in there. You know, it's all monospace font, which means that they very specifically chose words of a certain length to make sure that all the text is nice and justified. Or maybe it just worked out that way. Okay, this one isn't quite so perfect. So all the graphics in this game are in low resolution graphics mode, which is very chunky pixels that look sort of like an Atari 2600, sort of, that sort of, well, actually, I guess it's less resolution than even that. So yeah, this is just a very basic, like, economics lesson thing, I guess. You know, very, very stripped down and not really representative of reality. But, okay, so it costs 2 cents to make a glass of lemonade, so let's make 10 glasses, let's make 2 signs, so if each glass costs 2 cents, let's charge 5 cents a piece. That's 3 cents profit on each glass. Oh, right. But I made 2 signs, so that counteracts all the profit I would have made. It's like I'm a terrible business person or something. So the weather report will actually affect how many customers you get and stuff. Alright, well, let's try making 20 glasses of lemonade this time. Let's make 3 signs and let's charge 10 cents a glass. Hey, I made a profit. Look at me. I'm the world's most intelligent business person. Your mother quit giving you free sugar. Gotta pay for your sugar now. Let's make 30 glasses of lemonade. Let's make 5 signs, and let's charge 15 cents a glass. Well, I sold 25 out of 30. That's pretty good. Made a profit of $1.80. Heat wave is predicted. Well, dang, I should probably make like, let's go with 60. Let's make 5 signs. Let's charge 20 cents a glass. I'm feeling bold. It's hot and dry. People are going to want something to quench their thirst. Ooh, only sold 28 out of 60. Oh well, I still made a profit. Alright, let's make, 4 cents goes into 74, 16 times, sounds about right. Come on, be reasonable. $2 a glass. Oh, $2 a glass is totally unreasonable. Uh-oh, I didn't sell any lemonade. What do you mean? Beep. trash, so... You only have 46 cents left. Okay. I'll get 3 signs then. And I will charge $1 a glass. Brilliant. Well, someone actually bought one. I'm just trying to bankrupt myself to see what happens. Cent left. You don't have enough money left to stay in business. You're bankrupt. And that's it. Just boots you back to the main menu. So this program is basic, meaning it is a program that someone can write or someone wrote, and you can list out the program. And if you are an enterprising young computer user like I was, then you can try to figure out how the program is doing what it does and see if you can copy the code into your own programs and figure out how to make it work. So I'm using Control S to stop the program list and restart it. You can see all of the text that it displays, a lot of math going on here. The number on the left-hand side is the line number. Usually that's multiples of 10, but for whatever reason, whoever wrote this program added 1 to each. And on the copyright screen, it said this was copyright Apple Computer, which means some Apple employee actually wrote this program. And you can see the source code for what they wrote right here. So this might be the only open source program Apple's ever produced. You see a lot of pokes in there. That's stuff that I don't understand. That's interacting with binary code and assembly language and stuff, which was really frustrating when I was a kid, because the only basic programs that were actually fun always had a lot of stuff that I had no idea how it worked. So, let's load up another basic program here. Let's see. Where is that disk? Oh, I guess I should show off what the rest of this disk first. It's not really that interesting. So there's music recital, which is the Space Quirks, which is the closest thing to an actual game on here. This program must be exited by pressing Open Apple Control Reset. Hey Jaded. Oh, was that really loud? I'm sorry. I should probably turn my volume down on the program a little bit more. Let's see. Alright, I'll try turning it down to 25% instead of 50 here. Yeah, apologies to headphone users out there. The popping is kind of bad, really? Okay, let me make sure it's not my mic, because my mic was giving me issues and I had to open it up and mess with the cord. So I'm going to close the program completely. Let me know if you still hear it. So this is just me talking with no program running. Is the popping still there? The audio meter on OBS is not doing the weird thing anymore. It stopped. My microphone is fine. Okay, well, I guess if my only options are do an Apple II stream with the popping or not do it at all, then I'll just have to deal with the popping, and I apologize. Let me just make sure that there are no. So I had a mocking board enabled, which is like a very early Apple II sound card. But I don't think any of the programs I'm using will actually that might have been the culprit, because it looks like OBS isn't being weird anymore. Well, let's see what happens when I actually start up a disk. Yeah, OBS is still being weird, so you're probably still getting the popping. Yeah, sorry about that. But hopefully, actually, let's turn the Apple. I mean, you really don't need sound for any Apple program. The sound is almost universally just terrible. I'll turn this down to like 15%. Hopefully that's enough to make it a little bit less noticeable. Okay. So, let's see. Does it still recognize my joystick here? Yep, it does. Or it should. I guess they licensed this for inclusion on this disc, which is weird. Why would they show off a 3-year-old game on an Apple IIc disc? Okay, no biggie, Jaded. I appreciate you stopping in regardless. Oh boy. Escape for help. Okay, so let's turn the joystick on. And sound is on. So this is a very obvious Galaga clone. Whoa. So I have three tanks, or two tanks now. These enemies are very aggressive. And this is by Broderbund Software, and I had a ton of games by Broderbund. The Conan game, or Conan game, that I played in the last Apple II stream was also a Broderbund joint. Yeah, the only sound the Apple II makes that I actually enjoy is probably the really clicky, kind of ZX Spectrum sounding sound effects like this game has. Sort of has a... Not that one. But just the shooting and the sound it makes when you hit an enemy are very soothing. Whoa, screen hacks. Yeah, this isn't as much fun as Galaga. When you hit the enemies, they just kind of charge down to the bottom of the screen and immediately kill you. Oh well, that was fun. So let's reset. Is there anything else on this disc? Oh yeah, let's play the quick quiz. Oh right, there's a programming disc that I didn't have. I guess it was the only one that I was missing. But it taught you how to use Logo. Okay, well that's enough of that. This quiz is not very interesting. So let's load up another basic game here. I do have it in my list, don't I? Apparently not. I know I downloaded it. Hold on. What the hell? I know I downloaded this program. Sorry, bear with me a sec. Wow, it is nowhere to be found on my computer. I don't know what happened to it, but I can find it again real quick. On the good old Internet Archive, archive.org, which is where I got all of these programs. Not. Right, the one on the Internet Archive, I couldn't get to work. So I had to download this from a different site. Oh, man. Maybe I downloaded this at work. Talk about this game. Now, I know I put it in my damn Apple One directory. I don't know what happened to it. This is so frustrating. Does it have a different name? Oh, was it on this one? Hold on. Oh, the malware exhibition? No, I haven't seen that. That sounds amazing, though. Ah, yes, here it is. The disc was labeled Text Adventures, but this isn't exactly a text adventure. So this is one of the very common boot menus that people used for collections of pirated games. Basically, just it gives you a catalog of everything on the disc. And you see how everything has an A over there on the left-hand side? That means that's short for ASCII, A-S-C-I-I, which means that it is written in BASIC. And is not a binary program, or wasn't made in assembly language. So the game I'm here for is called House of Usher 2. And I have no idea if there was a House of Usher 1. This was the one that I had, and it actually took me forever to find a working copy of this. I don't remember where I actually found it now. It probably is on the archive somewhere, just it's not labeled what you think it would be labeled. So this is based on the Edgar Allan Poe short story, sort of, which I haven't read. High in the Cornish cliffs overlooking the English Channel awaits the evil House of Usher. For centuries, it has stood waiting for the unlucky traveler who may wander in. It is now your turn to see if you can survive the night. There are bats and cats and brain eaters. Shrinking rooms and all manners of perils. How many minutes can you survive the House of Usher? I don't know if the Edgar Allan Poe short story featured brain eaters, but if anyone has read that story, then you can chime in and say how close this is to the source material. So this is the movement screen. It shows you what keys you press to do what. And this was 1980, so this predated the Apple IIe. And the original Apple II and the Apple II Plus did not have arrow keys. They weren't introduced until the Apple IIe, which was 1982 or 83. So people kind of had to wing it and come up with their own solutions. So in this game, you press 1 to move up, 2 to move right, 3 to move down, and 4 to move left, which is complete nonsense. No brain eaters in House of Usher, according to Xenoch. For quick movements in a single direction, hold down 1 through 4 and the Rept key at the same time. This will enable you to move quite rapidly. Thanks to Barbara for this discovery. So, on the original... Oh, right! It has this weird countdown. You can always see how you are doing by looking at the bottom of the screen. Strength, how much energy you have left. Courage, points for bravery. Offense, your weapon strength. Defense, how much armor you have. Weight, how much you carry. Wealth, dollars worth of loot you have. Time, you have until 6 a.m. Move, direction, last move. Oh, that shows you which way you are going to shoot an arrow. And shoot is the number of arrows left. So instead of just giving you another press a key to continue, it gives you this forced countdown timer, I guess, just to make absolutely sure you read this. Oh, but then it still makes you press a key to go on. The time is quickly approaching. No turning back now. You may win by 1,000 points for courage or by getting 1,000 in wealth. How did Virginia die? What about the sounds behind the walls in the library? Where is the red room? Be the first to solve the mystery and win $100 in cash. Holy shit. So this is the low resolution graphics mode. Everything is a nice big old chunky pixel. And the way the Apple II handle color is by basically the position of lines on the screen, which is why in this column my sprite, quote unquote, is 4 lines wide, and in this column it's 3 lines wide. I'm not going to pretend to understand how any of that works. It's very technical, I assume, and kind of bizarre. But this is me. I'm that little purple block. And I have to collect things that look nothing like me. Sat down for a little rest. Camping out? Bitten by a termite. So I think that just took some stamina from me, maybe? Oh boy, these controls. So instead of using like WASD or something that makes sense, this is... It is just completely counterintuitive. And when the Apple II finally did introduce arrow keys, they weren't great. They were in a line rather than, you know, the cross shape or the inverted T shape that we're familiar with. But at least the arrow keys would have been 1 is up and 2 is down. So they kind of go together and sort of make sense a little bit more than this. Sorry, bench taken by a ghost. As far as I can tell, there's no way to look at something before you interact with it, so this whole game is sort of just trial and error. Just bumping into things and see what they are slash do. Got a sliver in your rear. Ouch. Man, that took like 100 stamina from me. Jeez. Oops. So Sorry, bench taken by a ghost. Yeah, exactly, Jaded. Like, why? Like, a lot of games used IJKM, which isn't great, but it would still be better than this. But you have to remember, this was 1980. People were still figuring this stuff out. I don't know why they didn't figure out something better than this, but it was a different time. Wow, a treasure. Silver tea set. So I can press 6 here to look at my objects, my inventory. Let's use my tea set. It's already in use. Okay. So you can see every time I move, the time ticks up one. Oh, right. It has to, like, refresh the screen twice for some reason. Every time I move, every two movements ticks the timer up by one. And we have until 6 a.m. to finish the game, so 12 hours. So let's go through this big old door here. We are in the entryway, which, you know, your guess for what this stuff is as good as mine. Oh, that's not a good sound. Wounded by gopher holes. Oh, man. I got a splinter, I was bitten by a termite, and I was wounded by gopher holes, and I'm almost dead. So, yeah, despite the shortcomings of this game, this was still very exciting to me as a kid. I was 12 when I played this. And, like I said, most games worth playing were, like, assembly language games that I had no clue about, but this was written in BASIC. And it's sort of a functioning game. It's sort of interesting, and I could see making my own adventure game in this sort of style, but actually good. But unfortunately, it uses a lot of binary files that I don't know how any of that works. A warlock is crouched before you and is ready to spring. You better run. Don't I have arrows, though? Whoa, why is he so fast? Greased warlock. Very badly wounded. Solid hit. It's nice of him to stay in my line of fire. Whoa, I didn't want that. Oh, what happened? The room reset when I did that? When I went to my inventory? And I don't get those arrows back. So to line up my shot here, I have to make sure that the last direction I moved was left. Oh, he gets all his health back. Just because I accidentally pressed 6 instead of 5. This AI programming could use some work. Also, if it's a warlock, I don't know why it's casting spells at me or anything, but I'll take it. Battles won. One. So I guess I got some courage points for that. I didn't see what my courage was before I slew the warlock. So this is a banquet hall, so I figure these are chairs around a table, right? Am I going to accidentally break my leg if I try to sit in one of the chairs? Dust, old bronze. Wait, what? Bit into something on the table and it squeaked and. Hey, I'm trying to read that. It squeaked and ran away. Feel a little sick. Uh oh. I collapsed from exhaustion because I accidentally ate a mouse. I guess. all your treasure have been stolen and you have failed. Try again. Press number one on keyboard, otherwise goodbye. Oh. Well, while we're here, let's take a look at the program. So yeah, remember how I said most basic programs, the lines were multiples of 10? The reason for that was so... Let's do a really basic program here just to demonstrate. Print hello, 20, print Matt. So we have hello Matt. So we can list this program out, and it has our line numbers there. Now, if we want to put something between these lines, we can use any number between 10 and 20. So I can go print my name is. Then when you run the program, it says, hello, my name is Matt. Just, and you have 10, 15, 20, and you can insert lines between these, you know, using however many numbers you have. And some people would list it, would, you know, they would make 100 their first line, just so they have a lot of room to work with. Now, of course, most... if your program has so many lines in it that you need 99 between each, just in case, you know, you need to insert that many things, then your program probably is going to be too big to run on the Apple. But... oops. Yeah, all of these programs are basic. I don't know what any of these are except for House of Usher. I'm going to have to go in and see what all of these are at some point. Wait a second. It doesn't have any of the binary files. That's weird. But yeah, House of Usher... it is just straight up numbers. Like, whoever wrote this program, like, I can't imagine what was involved in writing this program, just what went into it. Line number one is the you ran out of health, game over line. It is just such a mess of, like, nested routines and subroutines, and it is just... incomprehensible. So my excitement at this being a basic program was sort of tempered when I looked at the program list and realized that this was written by some sort of alien. Although you can get like hints and cheat and look ahead at stuff that's happening or stuff that's going to happen. Although, who knows, like, who knows when any of these things will happen. Maybe that's why it's written in such a weird way, so people can't look at the program and cheat and win the $100 prize that way. Crash before you. So this is, like, the Warlock text that it shows when I encountered the Warlock, but... I guess it's like you can slot other enemy types in there as well. There's a scrambling of hundreds of tiny little feet. There are man-eating... what? Man-eating something nearby. So these are variables. So I dollar sign parentheses RM is like... it's a string variable, but it's pulling data out of some sort of array somewhere. Yeah, this is just... Needless to say, this was incomprehensible to 12-year-old me. Ooh, there's piranhas in the water somewhere. And there's no way to, like, list it faster. You can break out of it by pressing Ctrl-C. But if you want to see the whole program and see where it ends, you just kind of have to sit here and wait for the whole thing to scroll by. If You can also list specific line numbers if you know what you're looking for. So you can see what line number 300 is. So it ends somewhere between 300 and 400. But yeah, this is just a huge basic program. It's 100 blocks of data, which I think there's 255. Well, no. That would be way too many when you add in all the other stuff. Huh, I don't know. But each disk is 140K, so whatever percentage 100 is, you know, it took up that much of the disk. I never actually made it very far in this game. It was just sort of interesting to me in an abstract way. Because, you know, this was 1980. I think this might have even predated Ultima 1. Let's see. Well, Ultima 1 was published in 1981. So yeah, this game was released before the first Ultima. So it is a very interesting artifact of the time, sort of a proto-RPG. Aw, man, the treasure is, like, down there. I can't get to it. I guess some stuff in this game is randomized. Maybe if I leave the screen and come back, it'll be in a different position. Man, you start with 998 stamina. And, like, stepping in a gopher hole took me down to, like, 600-something. There we go. Give me my tea set. Wait. What? Well, that's not fair. So this is even worse than trial and error. It's complete random chance. I thought that was a tea set every time. Well, that means this might not be a gopher hole this time. Oh, is it messing up because I loaded the program instead of... And the emulator just crashed. I don't think it liked the fact that I loaded the program and then ran it instead of running it from the menu. September 22nd, 1980. So this was about the time that Richard Garriott was working on Ultima, but they managed to get this game out to market before Ultima came out. I guess. I don't know if this program was actually for sale, like in stores. Presumably a box copy of it existed somewhere at some point, but I sure don't know where. Let's look real quick and see if there are any copies of this for sale on eBay. Nope. Man, look at this. Okay. So I found a picture of the baggie that contained the Atari 800 version of the game. I don't know if that came first or if the Apple version came first. Let's see, how hard would it be for me to... Can I just use a URL here? No. Oh well. Yep, there we go. So this is the Crystalware release of House of Usher on the Atari 800. And I don't know what the manual was originally, that horrible yellow color, but that's what it looks like. Oops. I wonder if anyone ever actually won the $100. Okay. Maybe now this will be the T-set, now that I loaded the program from the menu. Hey, there we go. Also, it was like messing up the names of things, so I guess it was just a weird glitch. But yeah, this is loading data from something. I don't know where. Like, in the non-working versions of this, the reason it didn't work was because it was trying to load a binary file that wasn't actually on the disk. But this disk doesn't have it either, or it doesn't seem to. Uh-oh, the Warlock is right next to the door this time. Yeah, let's try leaving and coming back. See if it's in a more advantageous position. There we go. Ah, damn it! Oh, these controls. Oh, and it's in a bad position again. I don't know what will happen if the Warlock reaches me, but it probably won't be good. Oops. Wasn't lined up. Arrow stuck in wall. Can I, like, pass time? I don't think I have a key for that. I don't want to go into my inventory or anything. Because it'll reset the room. You Warlock. Oh man, it's close. Man, that just took like half my stamina. All right, let's try this again. Hold on a sec. I have the faster loading turned on. I want to see what that title screen actually says. It's going by too fast for me to read it. Oh, it's going to make me restart the emulator. Oh well. And everything's going to take way longer to load now. Weird how that works. Oh well, you get the authentic. See, okay, so it's going B-load creatures. So B-load is the binary equivalent of load. So it's loading some sort of binary file into memory, but when I do catalog on the disk, it's not actually on there. It's very strange. Yeah, there's no key for just stand still for a second. I mean, this game did come out after Rogue, like the original Rogue. So there were some common, there was a common point of reference for how to move around a character in a tile-based system like this. But maybe they never played Rogue. You know? People didn't have the internet back then. You know, at best, they would have been able to download it from a BBS system. Actually, I don't know if there was an Apple port of Rogue or not. I figured there would have been. I think there was a port of Rogue for everything, but maybe not. You know, just leave your silver tea set sitting around in the driveway, or whatever this is, the main drive, with benches. Alright, let's take care of this. I mean, we have so many ways we could be going, but I wanna get some courage. I wanna take out that warlock, since I know that it's within my capabilities. Excuse me, Mr. Warlock. No. Too close. There we go. I just need him to move down one space or up a couple spaces. I forgot what my... Oh, man. Okay, this is also doable. Alright, 3 to move down, 4 to move left. 5 to shoot. Now the question is, do I want to move down, or do I want to see if he'll move back up? No, he's still moving down. Alright, 206 health. As long as he doesn't move up or down too much, then I should be able to take him out. Oh yeah, I got him. Sweet. And of course, there's no way to save my game or anything, so I got 168 courage for that, and I need 1,000 to win, or 1,000 wealth, and I have 67 wealth. So I'm not even going to mess with this table or these chairs. Didn't seem like there was anything good there. Servants' hall. So this could either be a treasure or a trap. Who knows? It's just a gray box. We won't find out until we bump into it. I have found some protection against the monsters. A bear skin. Do I have to equip it? Nope, it's already in use. Okay. Do I have armor on my... Oh, defense, 164, okay. Also, you lose stamina just as you move from room to room, so it's sort of like an all-purpose energy meter. Garden paths. So who knows what any of this is? Not me. Witch's Healing Brew of Mandrake Root, sweet. I guess it's in my inventory and I have to use it. Also, if you don't want to use anything, there's no obvious way to back out of this menu. So I just press enter, and I guess it uses nothing. So yeah, the only thing that actually counts as wealth is the treasure. The other stuff, it has a value, but it's not... The value doesn't count towards your wealth total. Hey, Chimnator, welcome. You were born in the wrong generation. Did you want to be born in the generation where you had games like this? Graveyard. Oh, I probably shouldn't mess with any of this, should I? I don't think I've ever played a game where messing around in a graveyard was a good idea. So I'm just going to... Well, this one over here is like, it's not on the grid. So this might be a treasure. I should probably investigate it. A mystery object. Blanket. It is magical and it affects your defense. Nice. Old games had a much more rich experience. Well, they were certainly more mysterious. I'll give them that. Usher's Crypt. Wait. Why am I outside the boundaries of the room? Well, let me... So if you like solving mysteries, then this era of software was the one for you. For example, the mystery of why am I outside this room and how do I get back in? Can I go anywhere from here? Can I shoot my way through this wall? No. Let's drink my mandrake root tonic. Stamina increased by 128. Wait. What the hell is this block up in the corner of the screen now? Also, did it actually increase my stamina by that much? I don't feel like it did. Bad subscript error. Okay, well, I guess we lose. Well, we know not to go that way now. Let's see what some of these other doors have. And the thing is, since this is just a bootleg copy, I don't know if that error was in the original or if it's there because it's a copy or what's going on. I don't remember encountering that when I had this as a kid. Oh man, I loaded it instead of running it. Hopefully that doesn't mess it up. Crystal Computer Manufacturing and Software. They write computer software, but they also manufacture something. Crystals? I'm sorry if I'm spending too much time on this game. I haven't played it extensively for 20 years. This is bringing back a lot of memories of trying to figure out how shit works and having it break unexpectedly for no reason. To go on any key. Yeah, one theme that you'll find in small, independently made software of this time was not a great amount of attention paid to spelling and grammar. Alright, I should probably at least kill the warlock and then keep going in that direction for a little bit because I have the healing tonic and the blanket that way. Oh, and, well, no, the blanket was where it broke, I think. But I can get the healing tonic and the bearskin. some sort of witch's brew. It is costing me a little bit of stamina every time I go through one of these doors. So this isn't like free loot or anything. But I think it'll be worth it. Oh, come on! You're not supposed to move that many times. He's getting too close. I'm gonna have to bail. I just wasted 4 arrows. That sucks. Nope. Oh, come on, you jerk. Just go back and forth like you were doing. I like that pattern a lot more. Now that's a hell of a shot. Oh, come on. What are you doing? I can't hit you this way. Oh, now you're down there? Well, that's not good for anyone. What? Sometimes you can just move like 3 times in a row for no reason. Okay, this warlock isn't going to cooperate. I'm going somewhere else. Maybe I'll come back for the warlock later. Maybe not. See what some of these other rooms have. A fungus man has crouched before you and is ready to spring. So yeah, same dialogue, different enemy name swapped in. Well, I guess if the fungus man doesn't have much health, this might be an okay fight. Nah, he has about as much health as the warlock. Maybe if he spawns in a better position. No. Wait, wouldn't that purple door up there just take me back into the warlock room? But I don't think there was an actual door there. It's like non-Euclidean geometry. Yeah, there's no door there. I spawned on top of the gopher hole, I think. Well, I guess me spawning on it caused it to become telefragged. Conservatory. What do you suppose this thing is? Crunch. Piano top slams on finger. Oh man, I just lost a bunch of courage for that. Oh, I'm back in the garden now. Weird. Oh, what's this thing? It's 50-50 whether it's a treasure or a trap. No, oh, the ghost of someone has appeared and vanished again. Okay. Kind of want to know where that door actually goes. I don't know if I can get there before the fungus man eats me. it again. Secret passages. Oh, man. Unfortunately, I spawned outside the secret passages again. See if I go into my inventory and then bounce out. Maybe it will reset my position. No. Put something on the screen, though. I bet if I bump into it, it's going to make the game crash again. Yep, bad subscript error. Alright, let's try one more path. I wish I knew if these bugs were there in the original. I guess I never actually played the original, well, quote-unquote original, the copy that I had. I certainly didn't own a retail copy of this game, but I don't remember it ever crashing, but I also didn't actually play it that much, because it's incomprehensible and I was 12. I have a little bit more patience now, just because it's kind of a weird thing that's interesting. Yeah, that was the thing. This game fascinated me because even as a 12-year-old, I could tell what was wrong with the game because I have played games that, you know, were years newer and people knew what good game design was, and I could apply my present-day knowledge to this, you know, this format of game from the past and make something better. Of course, even back then, I was under no delusions that I would ever be able to sell a game or share it with anyone because, you know, BBSs weren't a thing anymore. I just wanted to make something, which I guess is still my goal, is just to make things, not necessarily to become a successful software developer or anything. I just want to make fun stuff, or interesting stuff, at least. And the one thing you can say about this game is that it is definitely interesting. Alright, let's see what this weird passage is. I don't know what this is. Oh, I'm in the East Wing. Also, a duplicate of me spawned outside. I'm playing on an emulator, Chibnator. I'd love to have an Apple IIc again, but I don't know how I would capture video from it. And I spawned outside the bounds of the room again. Great. Okay, well. I don't remember. Yeah, I don't remember any of this happening when I played. Yeah, I'm using Apple Win, which is kind of the gold standard of Apple II emulation programs for Windows. Alright, well, speaking of weird adventure games, let's load up another game. Although this time I have to put game in sneer quotes or scare quotes. Some sort of quotes. I don't know if this game is worth sneering at, but it is certainly a unique experience. So yeah, it was common for software pirates at the time to add these little I don't know what to call it, splash screen to the game. And on other computers like the Commodore 64 and the Amiga that had much better graphics capabilities, they could do a lot of really cool screen effects with it. But for the Apple II, you kind of had to take what you had. So this is Blood Quest by Elroy N. Erdling, which is, I'm sure, a person's actual name. Create your adventurer, Matt. So, my something is that number. My strength is that number. Cunningness, religion, fear, health, height, sex. Yeah, I say my sex is about a 12.35. That's accurate. Taste, agility, language, horse sense, caloric intake, 75.8. I'm pretty sure that would kill me after a day or two. Okay, looks pretty good. So it's doing this thing where it's loading data into memory just to make it look like the disk drive is doing something, but it's not actually loading anything. This is like a precursor to the old reticulating splines joke. And this is another reason I wanted to turn the disk speed back to the authentic, because this game would just go way too fast if I had it on the enhanced disk speed. Can I control S here? I forget. No. Okay, well, enjoy this story. Oh, I can't control S. It just doesn't stop it until the end of the sentence. So yeah, this is also written in BASIC, but with very strong reliance on binary data. Avenge the death of my great aunt Phoebe at the hands of Einar the Oaf. So yeah, it just repeats a bunch of the text a few times and just scrolls it really fast. Save the game frequently and also look both ways before crossing the street. You're in a dark maze. Sounds of a bubbling stream come from somewhere ahead. This isn't some cheap two-word parser. Type complete sentences. Okay. Take inventory. Oh, here we go. I have a pack of gum, string, a key, a doorknob, a book of matches, shoes, 7 shoelaces, 3 big pins, mysterious box of smells, and bottle of yellow stuff. Okay. Chew gum. Well, that didn't get me out of the maze, unfortunately. I don't know how to use a key. Go to the stream. You will probably be stuck in the maze for eternity. Drink water. Try saying go stream. You know, after I just said, it's not a cheap two-word parser. Type complete sentences. Oh, nothing there. Listen stream, okay. Try thinking on your own. Oh, apparently I solved the maze. So yeah, this doesn't actually respond to anything you type in, except a few joke commands. Apparently I picked up a bottle of green stuff, some athletic socks, a map of Gordothnica. Directions out, that'll come in handy. sun. Get sand. Okay. Oh, getting the sand caused me to lose everything else. Oops. Without warning, you face 10 defenseless orcs. It's loading something. You draw your weapons and attack, slashing and hacking. Hey! Look at that. I'm more successful with this game than I was House of Usher. Off to the left is a pleasant valley, but a sinister cave is a lot closer. You can't move that there. Still only have zip. Yeah, this image was corrupted on my copy of the game too. I don't know why it's messed up like that. Some sort of lizard-like creature, I guess. Oh, good game, everyone. Just as you died, magic happened and you came to life to continue your amazing adventure. When I press enter on the inventory screen, it tries to do some sort of command for some reason. Also, this is a very strange interface because normally you can't have high resolution graphics and text on the screen at the same time. Well, not like text mode text. You would have to, draw text on the screen. But somehow they made this work, and I'm not sure how. That word is not in my vocabulary. Yeah, it just sort of randomly teleports you from one location to the next. This is obviously just some joke project that someone threw together that they were probably trying to turn into something bigger, and they drew all these images and just wanted to use them all. I don't know why I typed dir. It's not an Apple command. I stomped to death by a giant chicken. Causing you to implode, as you do. The gods look down on you? Why would they bring me back to life if they look down on me? Well, let's do what you always have to do in these games and see if it responds to swear words. Because, the important thing in these games was making you feel acknowledged when you try typing in a swear word. you are in front of a haunted house, marveling at the special effects. Oh, we got that again. Oh, and we have our stuff back. Nice. You can't use directions inside or out. What? Book of Kings? What? Oh, nice. It's stuck real hard. It's not even giving me feedback now. Totally awesome. Oops. Actually, let's see if it responds to lowercase letters. I said that. You said it was stuck. I don't think it responds to lowercase. Receiving no answer is okay. Yeah. This is just a bunch of random stuff stuck together. But apparently we win. Smells, barnyard. Friends, none. Wah, wah. Can I do anything from this screen? Oh. The program crashed. Return without ghost sub error in 2800. Oh, it was trying to return to something. I don't know what. Copy protect enabled. Yeah, it's very important that you have DRM on this kind of software. Yeah, just a huge tangled mess of go-tos and go-subs. You know, REM is short for remark, which is like what they used to comment code at this time. And the only code comment was something saying, hey, this disk is copy protected, you know. Don't comment any of the rest of the code and let people know how any of this shit works. If X is less than 3 and F9 is less than 1, then $ equals this isn't some cheap two-word parser type complete sentences. So I guess that's the number of words. X is the number of words, and F9, I don't know what that would represent. Yeah. If $1 equals fuck, then $ equals not in my house. You know, super important joke. Oh, you can say please, and they'll say manners won't do you any good here. Oh, it just, if you try to use anything, it just says, I don't know how to use it. And a bunch of poke commands, which are accessing probably just... I figure in this game the poke commands are just for the graphical data, because there's nothing else that you wouldn't be able to do in BASIC, I think. 25 unarmed pilgrims, 10 defenseless orcs, 75 furry cute little gerbils cowering in the dust. Some of the various monsters you can fight. I don't know how it determines which inventory screen to show you. And that's the whole thing. That's the entire program. So remember when it said save the game frequently and always? Someone literally saved a file called the game frequently and always. I think that's the actual Blood Quest program. Oh, when you see a little asterisk next to a program, that means it's locked, which means it won't let you delete it by accident. So, let's see, what was that called? Picture Shower. So I can go... I think. Yeah. So now it's unlocked and I can go in there, delete it if I wanted to. Yeah, it looks like the binary files are probably all pictures on this. All kinds of high-res pictures. Yep, that's a desert. Questware software. Let's see, are there any of these that we didn't see? I don't think so. Oh, that's Monster 2. So Monster 1 is probably the corrupted one, right? Yeah, it's just messed up on the disk. It must have been messed up in the original. Because the copy that I had did that as well. Once again, just a total mess of code, you know, no comments. Well, no, there's actually some comments here. So Y equals the number of pictures, so if you wanted to have a different number of pictures in the list, you can go in there and change the Y equals 15. That's kind of cool. Display titles. Bunch of poking. Oops. By the way, if you ever see me type a command, but it gives me an error, so Control H is back. Like, if you accidentally hit Control and then a key while you're typing a command, it will interpret that as part of the command and not be able to parse it. Okay, I just want to try one more thing real quick with this before I move on. Oh, not this. Let's just reset here. Alright. Oh, okay, good. You can actually skip that. That's nice of them. You probably don't want to call any of these phone numbers. I doubt you'll be able to get any sweet wares from them anymore. No year on this. No idea when this was made. Right, I had to go through this whole beginning sequence again. I just wanted to get into the main game, because I don't think does it ever actually use my name? I don't think so. Except here. you know, a great way to introduce the illusion of interactivity is to ask the player for a name that you never actually use. That cursor's doing there. That's very strange. Alright, let's see if we can actually read the story this time. Long time ago, in a kingdom reasonably close to where you were sitting, plague and famine were rampant throughout the land. Brutality was the only law at all, and you were the only one who could change anything. Armed with only your humming dagger, you set out on a quest filled with blood, a quest of blood, blood quest. You had to cross many strange landscapes, wide oceans, to avenge the death of your great aunt Phoebe at the hands of Einar. Oh, it's Einar the Off, not Einar the Oaf. Monsters will have to be slain and fair maidens rescued. Some of them might even be considered good. That's a pretty good joke. Fair maidens, good maidens. You will meet tufted Melmoths, craftnip Drelbs, and even the dreaded outlaw Yodar Critch. Magic will play a great part in your adventure, so be sure to use it a lot. Map the maze carefully, as it could save your life. Oh, shoot. Well, it wouldn't let me control S after it started doing the extremely fast scrolling. Oh, but now it control S's. Xenox says, I'm back. Okay. Sorry about that, everyone. The stream was having issues. I'm going to have to stop streaming on YouTube. Something like this happens every single time. I'm just going to have to go back to Twitch. Okay. Yeah, I was wondering if I could break out of this. In basic programs, you can press Control C to break out and get back to DOS. But it looks like it has some sort of protection against that. Oh, there we go. So how the hell does this graphics mode work? I didn't think you could have text on the screen and high resolution graphics. See how much of this I can remember. So if you can see that gray pixel there, I just made I plotted a point at 20, 20. Okay, yeah, that totally works. I can just draw a line. Oh, well, shoot. There is a way to sort of not have to retype the line in again. Is it actually drawing stuff? Oh man, what was the key? There's some sort of keyboard command. No, it's not that. there's a way to make the cursor go up. Oh, that's Control G. That's the beep command. So we can get back into text mode here. Was it a control thing, or was it something else? Anyway, there's definitely a way to break out and move the cursor around. Oh, it's just escape. Okay. Oh, you can't have text with high res graphics. I don't know why I thought you couldn't. So, if we do GR, it goes into low resolution graphics mode. Which has the big chunky Atari 2600 style blocks there. Then HDR is high resolution graphics, which I thought for sure you couldn't do this and have text at the same time. I guess I was wrong. Let's just make a really quick program here just for funsies. Each color equals 5, 20. I forget what the high resolution. I forget what the high resolution is. It's like 192 by something. It's pretty low. So let's do X equals INT. D1. Times 50 plus 1. And then for 30, we can do the same thing, hit escape, and then make the same variable with y instead of x. So, and then 40, we do hplot x, y. And then 50, go to 20. Oh. Well, shoot. I think I have an extra parentheses in there or something. 1, 2, 3. Oh, I don't have another. I need another closing parenthesis. Well, no, I guess I don't need this one at all, right? Which means. So, like I was saying, the way it says your cursor works in our Apple II introductory disk doesn't work. That's not how it works at all in BASIC or in DOS. The blinking cursor is, you know, it's like a checkerboard pattern instead of the line pattern. And if you press the backspace key, it does that. Which, I don't know what the point of that is, but that's what it does. All right, let's edit line number 30 here. So to get rid of something in a line, crap. If you mess up, you can always just press Control X to bail out of whatever you're doing. So you would just have to press space to get rid of one of the parentheses. And then unlike in the how to use your computer disk, if you just press enter here, it will erase everything after the cursor. So you have to actually go to the end of the line. All right, I forgot to go into graphics mode. Let's see, 5 HDR. So there we go. Just a quick little program to plot a bunch of points onto the screen randomly. I don't know why it's just a tiny little square. Like 50 should be a much larger portion of the screen than that. I don't know. Oh well, that's high resolution graphics mode. I just want to test something real quick. So this is my master disk. This is just a blank disk that doesn't have anything on it but the operating system. Hello is just a whatever program is named Hello, that's the program that will run as soon as you boot up the disk. So this doesn't actually have anything in it. You just need kind of a dummy file there to make the disk boot. Yeah, you can totally have text and high-res graphics. Okay. It was for me into Mona Lisa. Yeah, I should have let it keep going and just let it fill up that little square. Oh, it's HDR2. That's how you fill up the whole screen with graphics. Okay. Yeah, it's coming back to me. Okay, well, that's enough of that amateur software. Let's get some actual, some game-ass games in here. So this game was on a number of different computers, and the version on the Apple, I believe, is different than most of the other ones from the videos that I've seen. Oh, I'm going to have to... Oh, okay. It was just loading the boot program. So this is BC's Quest for Tires. This might have been the very first auto runner. It's not an endless runner because it does have an end. But you move automatically in this game. I should probably switch the disc speed back to enhanced. A mod by Mr. Clean. Yeah, this is another thing that people who pirated software would do. They would just put these cheats, just build them into the game. I'll go with 9. By Sydney. Oh, thanks, Sydney. Number of players? 1. This is a Sierra Online joint. Oh, it's not recognizing my joystick. Crap. Hold on. There we go. So this is based on the comic strip BC, which has been around for 170 years and is still going somehow. This is a comic strip about cavemen. And this is the license game that we had, or that they had back in 1983. You just sort of automatically roll on your wheel here. I don't know why it's a quest for tires, because I clearly already have a tire. Or maybe I have a wheel, but we haven't invented something to put on the wheel yet. I'm not sure. So I'm pressing up on the joystick here to jump. You can press one button to increase your speed and one button to decrease it. Hey, Benno2O, welcome. Yeah, I do still stream all the time. I've been streaming on YouTube for a while, but recently I started streaming on both YouTube and Twitch simultaneously, since I have the ability to do that now. I figure there are a lot of people who follow me on Twitch who just never realized that I switched to YouTube. So, yeah, good to see you too. Thanks for watching. Ah, crap. I mean, Zot. You can't say crap in the newspaper. That'll get William Randolph Hearst on your ass so fast, your head will spin. Dang it. Well, it's a good thing I have 9 wheels. Or I started with 9 wheels. Maybe I shouldn't be going the maximum speed for this section. Let's try 70. Oh god, that's so slow though. I could go the nice speed. You know, not too fast, not too slow. Just nice. I wonder if the author of BC ever played this game. Can I explain multi-streaming in detail? So I'm using a Windows program called NGINX, I think. I might have some of those letters wrong, but I don't know if I can go in detail because I just followed a guide to set it up. But basically, I'm running a streaming server on my computer, and I set OBS to stream to that. And then that server is breaking up the signal and splitting it out to YouTube and Twitch. The vehicle makes even less sense than the ones in Flintstones. Yeah, I mean, it's a unicycle, but there's no pedals, no method of propulsion. You can also use a website called Restream.io to stream out to multiple things. They also support Hitbox and or whatever Hitbox is called now, and Mixer, and all the streaming sites. But the reason I'm doing it this way is because, theoretically, there's less lag between my stream and what you actually see. I don't know if that's true in practice or not. Oh wait, are there Twitch rules about not multi-streaming? Because Restream.io has been streaming out to multiple sites for a long time. If Twitch has some sort of rule about not streaming to other sites at the same time, then I'm unaware of it. And also quite a few people would be in violation of that. I know Giant Bomb, they stream out to multiple streaming sites on the reg. They use YouTube, Twitch, and their own server. Uh-oh. Phew. It's a good thing you can press down on the joystick to duck. Otherwise I would've... Whoa, that's fast. Otherwise I would've got my head clobbered in. Zot. Zot. I should probably go the minimum speed for this one. Aw, man. Do I actually have to duck there? I felt like I was on the ground. I guess there is one pixel that will intersect my head if I don't duck there. Also, how come he doesn't have hair? Cavemen, you know, one of the things they were known for is having a lot of hair. Just look at Captain Caveman. He's nothing but hair, practically. Whoa! Okay. Hey, I won! Look at that. And it just starts over. Now my minimum speed is 20 instead of 10. I guess if I beat it 6 more times, then I'll have to get through the whole game going a speed of 80 without being able to slow down. But that's kind of how games were back then. You know, they take 5 to 15 minutes to beat, and after that, it's like, hey, you did it. Now beat it when it's harder a little bit, sort of. But yeah, that's the whole game. That's my BC's Quest for Tires long play. Thanks for watching, everyone. Let's do another one. I don't know if this was on other computers or not. I could look it up real quick, but that would be less time I have to play video games. This is another Sierra Online joint. Known for revolutionary, expansive adventure games, and also a bunch of weird arcadey shovelware. This is Sammy Lightfoot. I think I'll actually have to switch this one over to joystick manually. All of these games do support the keyboard, of course, but as you saw with House of Usher, sometimes keyboard controls didn't make as much sense as one would like them to. So, generally better to use the joystick if you have the option to. Alright, how do I... Escape is just pause, I think. Is it O? Well, let's try open apple question mark and see if... Oh, so open apple jumps. Oh, okay. It just supports the joystick. I guess I was misremembering. I thought I had to set it up. I thought there was an option screen somewhere, though. Oh, there we go. Control O. Number of players 1. Type of control. Sound effects on. Start of scene tunes on. Reset high scores. Return. Oh, so I... Oh, can I... Oh. So you press spacebar to cycle between the options here. Let's reset the high scores. Accomplished! And there's also a level select. You can save the options. And you can play Sammy Lightfoot. So this is just a very basic kind of platformer arcade game. Mostly I just love this dude's walk animation. It is extremely good. That's how I walk all the time. You know, my goal is to live my life like Sammy Lightfoot. My hair is a giant duck's ass. I have a beer belly and a mustache. At least I think that's a mustache. It might be his mouth. It's hard to be sure. And I walk like this all the time. I make literally thousands of dollars a year. You can too. Just emulate Sammy Lightfoot. I don't mean emulate the game Sammy Lightfoot, although you can do that. I mean emulate his style. His physique. His philosophy. You know, be cool. Be like Sammy Lightfoot. I played this game before I ever heard of the band Gordon Lightfoot, and I thought it was a Sammy Lightfoot reference. That's what happens when your culture is just a mishmash of pirated software and crap you watch on TV. Different victory tune. So where it says level 0, that refers to the difficulty level, not actual levels in the game. That's just the scene. Uh-oh. Phew. I don't think you actually die if you run out of time. Like, you see my bonus counting down at the bottom there. I think if that becomes 0, you just don't get any bonus points when you finish, so... I don't think it's a hard and fast time limit or anything. Whew! I wasn't sure if I would grab that or not. Oh, man. Ooh. And when you die, your hair does that. You know, just like in real life. What's with the annoying orange up there? They weren't supposed to invent the annoying orange for several more years. This game is a time paradox. You know, as basic as this game is, it is at least not a ripoff of some other game. I'd say most of the action arcade style games you saw on the Apple were either licensed ported arcade games or rip-offs of the same arcade games. This isn't directly ripping off any game, as far as I know. It has some stuff in common with Pitfall, with the swinging vines here. Oh yeah. Oh, play that funky tune, Sammy Lightfoot. And that's it. That's the entire game. Those three scenes, and it just starts over at a slightly higher difficulty level. Now the boulders are coming from that side of the screen as well. It was really hard to find a game on the Apple II that would entertain you for longer than like 15 minutes. A surprising number of the games you played were like this. Which, you know, it was a limitation of the system, of course, and they were still very heavily inspired by arcade games, where that's sort of what you did. You just played the same few levels over and over, and it gradually gets higher. Wonder how high the difficulty level goes. Alright, let's see what level 6 Sammy Lightfoot looks like. Might have to reset the game. Actually, I don't know how to... Oh, I guess I just need to die and restart. Which shouldn't take long. Oops, I didn't actually mean to hit the trampoline. You couldn't really draw sprites on top of other sprites, so they just kind of intersect with each other and cancel each other out. Of course, for that sweet death animation, it has to get rid of the boulder sprite and redraw. Hey, I made it to the top 10. Oh, why did I put butt? I should have put ass. That would be way better. Alright, so can I start out at level 6 now? Yep. Alright, this is top tier Sammy Lightfoot play, everyone. Get ready. Oh, look at how fast that orange is moving. And these boulders. You would have to be the world's greatest Sammy Lightfoot player to get past this. Nope. So you can probably see why I wasn't too worried about beating the higher difficulty levels. Just imagine that there are five other levels of difficulty between the beginning and this. And this isn't, I mean, this is hard, but it's not like, well, I don't know how this is even possible. It's just a very granular level of difficulty. Yeah. I don't know how you're supposed to time that. It's quite possible that they intentionally made it impossible to beat the highest difficulty level, just to give it an air of, I don't know, mystique. It's like, oh man, no one's ever seen the end of Sammy Lightfoot. No one's ever made it past level 6. You wouldn't expect people making a game to make it impossible, but I'm not ruling out. Oh well, speaking of games that only have a few levels that you play over and over again, the Apple II actually had a pretty decent version of Donkey Kong. and I played it quite a bit. Hey, CPC Gamer, welcome. So this is a Nintendo game ported by Atari, or published by Atari, on an Apple computer. That's a sentence that you don't get to say very often. Oh, it's still loading. Weird. I can probably handle level 3. So it actually has the high how can you get screen, how high can you get screen, which a lot of computers of the time didn't bother with. That was in the arcade version. I never played a game called Willy the Worm, CPC Gamer, and I'm not sure what that is, so I don't know if it had a similar game. Another really good walk cycle here. It reminds me of those animated GIFs of Sonic the Hedgehog. Like fan art, where someone draws Sonic running and it's just, his limbs are just flailing, splayed out everywhere. That's what Mario's walk cycle reminds me of here. Also, no mustache. This is one of the only examples ever of a clean-shaven Mario. Also, the super off-key version of that music. I think this had more levels than a lot of the Donkey Kong ports of the time as well. Or more screens, I should say. Because at the time, level meant difficulty level. Oh, so this thing is like a conveyor belt, even though it doesn't actually look like one. So what's my goal here? Do I just need to get to the top? I think so. Oh no! Yeah, this is the stage that a lot of the ports left out. As CPC Gamer points out, the Pie Factory. Although it looks less like a Pie Factory in this version, but at least it's here. I think there were 4 stages, and most home computers. Oh no! The thing just spawned on top of me. Yeah, most home computer ports of this game only had 4 out of the 5. I need to turn the better disk speed back on. I don't think any of the other games I have will be affected by it. Well, I'll do that after I game over here. Looks more like a bowl of dog food factory. Nope. I have 3 lives left somehow. We're 2 now. I'm just going to turn the disc speed back up. This is bothering me. There we go. Look at that. Well, I gave you a taste of what things were like back in the Dark Ages. See, this thing just instantly loads. You don't have to wait for it. Okay. I'll start on level 1. Look at this just jumble of graphics when Mario intersects the ladder. Like, this is just, it's really good. save you, Pauline. Separate the girders from each other. You can grab this hammer and kill all of these enemies if you're worried about points, I guess. Although it makes the stage take way longer than it otherwise would because you can't climb with a ladder. So, in the end, I don't know if it's worth it or not. There was an Apple II version of Donkey Kong Jr. or not. I'd say probably not, because that game was a lot more complex. Story as old as time. So this is level... Oh, I was looking at the level, not my lives. I don't think... Oh, my lives are down at the bottom. Okay, I was looking at the L equals up there at the top, and I thought that... Oops! I thought that was my lives. So yeah, it's kind of interesting that they let you just skip straight to level 5, because I figure that is skipping a lot of the content in the game, sort of. But in addition to just being a harder version of this level, of the screen, it also adds additional screens as the level goes up. Yeah, it is busted jank, CPC Gamer, but it's also surprisingly playable. Of course, at the time, I would have been using an Apple II joystick, which is not nearly as nice as an Xbox 360 controller. Although the Apple II joystick was analog, so this isn't a bad approximation of what playing a game felt like. It was an analog stick and two buttons. Of course, this game doesn't use analog, it's purely digital. But you know, it was one of the few analog joysticks of the day. And that might have come later, actually. I don't know if the original Apple II had an analog joystick, but the one I had was certainly analog. So the thing about these games is that if you fall one pixel too far, then that's just, that's all she wrote. But I do have a game here that shows off the analog nature of the joystick. And the version that I had, this was just called Breakout. But everything I see online refers to it as Break Trough. BREAKTROUGH. And that's like on every site that references this game. Which, obviously, it's supposed to be Breakthrough, but... It's weird that every site would emulate that, or every site would duplicate that spelling. So, this is your paddle. The sensitivity is incredibly high, and it was like this in the original as well. This game is almost unplayable with a joystick. I think it was intended for paddles, because the analog joystick, really, all it did was the left and right axis of the joystick was paddle 1, and then the up and down axis was paddle 2. So, you can play joystick games with the paddles and vice versa. And this is technically playable with the joystick. But, you know, it's kind of a trip to think that this is... I don't know when this game was made. There's no information about this game. There's no title screen or copyright or anything, but this is totally playable on the basic Apple II, which came out in 1981. And compared to a lot of computers of 1981, the animation is really smooth. The physics on the ball are actually pretty good. You have an extremely high degree of control over this paddle compared to other games of 1981. Oh, there we go. That's what you want to do in this game. I've never actually cleared the entire screen because I don't know if it's possible. A lot of people on my last Apple II video were a little peeved that I kept comparing the Apple II games to like an NES. But that's just because the NES was the game console that I had as a kid, and it was my frame of reference for 8-bit games. And the Apple II, despite its age, is an 8-bit computer, and it's the closest point of comparison I had. And obviously the NES came out 4 years later than the Apple II, and it was specifically designed to play games, and it's not really a fair comparison. But, you know, I have to give the Apple II credit. It could do a lot of things in 1981 that other computers just couldn't. I mean, look at IBM compatible games from 1981. You won't find anything with this kind of smooth animation, and, you know, a lot of breakout clones of the time, the ball could only go in very narrowly defined directions, you know, very, very specifically defined angles. And this one, you can go pretty much any direction you want, within reason. And where the ball hits the paddle actually has a huge effect on affecting the trajectory of the ball. Like, if I had an actual paddle controller, then this would probably be a lot easier to play. I guess I could use my mouse to emulate a paddle, but, you know, this is how I played the game as a kid, with an analog joystick that just, you know, you let go of the joystick, it just springs back to the middle. You have to finesse it. So that was Break Trough. Let's see, what else do I have here? Oh, here's an interesting game from 1981. Actually, I want to look something up real quick. Hold on. Wow. Okay. So I thought this game was a bad ripoff of Lode Runner, but Lode Runner didn't come out until 1983. Oh, that's very interesting. Let's see, I'll play the joystick version. Prepare yourself. Oh, actually, let's look at the title screen for a second. I want to make sure this is the 1981 game. Oh, this is just like a crack screen. Okay, well, the disc is labeled 1981, so I only have to assume that this came out in 81. But yeah, this is Apple Panic. I'm going to restart it so I can use the joystick. So Lode Runner was a very influential game of the time, a very good game for the time, and I guess it was inspired by this. Well, CPC Gamer says YouTube is bugging out. Yeah, I'm gonna have to just start using Twitch. I don't know what's going on with YouTube lately. Sorry everyone on YouTube. So you press the first joystick button to dig a hole, and you press the other button to fill the hole in. So you have to trap these enemies. And this game isn't as good as Lode Runner. In Lode Runner, you can jump. You can't jump in this. And you can dig either on your left or your right side. And the levels were a lot more puzzle-focused. And I thought this game was just a bad ripoff of Lode Runner, but if this game predated Lode Runner, then I guess I can't hold that against it. Oh, you dig so slowly. Jeez. Yeah, Lode Runner rules. Had a level editor. You can make really involved puzzle levels. It was cool. This game, not so much. It's really slow. So, I'm not pressing the stick right now. Once you press in a direction, your character just keeps walking that way. And then you can press the dig button to stop yourself. But also, look at this. Like, if your walk animation is in this part of the cycle, then you can't dig. You have to step a little bit. Or, I guess you have to be aligned to the grid on which the game allows you to dig. Also, these enemies are... Their movement is pretty random. It can be hard to trick them into falling into your hole. And if I remember correctly, Lode Runner has a pretty predictable enemy movement system. Like, if you're on the same level as them, they always move towards you, or something along those lines. Oh, okay. And in this version, or in this game, you just kind of have to get lucky. Try to beat at least one level here. Yeah, this thing is not going to do what I want it to. I mean, I guess I could just leave this hole here. Just dig holes everywhere. Wait for it to fall into one of them. So yeah, the next level is just more ladders and platforms and more enemies. You know, there's no jumping, so there's no platforming. You can fall through your own holes. There's no fall damage or anything, but... Yeah, this is just a very basic kind of bad version of Lode Runner. And I am very shocked to learn that Lode Runner came out after this. Wait, is this by the same person? Hold on. Oh, I don't think it actually has credit here. Twitch is buffering a whole bunch? Shit, I'm sorry. I mean, they're both published by Broderbund. I need to see who made this game. Hold on. Programmed by Ben Sarkey. Oh, this game was ported to other platforms. This was on the Atari 8-bit computers and the Commodore VIC-20. This game is an example of the trap-em-up genre, which also includes games like Heianco Alien, Lode Runner, and Boomer's Adventure in Asmic World. Okay. Okay, well, I can't talk shit about this game if it came out before Lode Runner. I thought Lode Runner was way earlier than 83, but I guess not. Let's see, what else do we have here? Well, here's another example of a game which is worse than its inspiration. This has to have... Yeah. So the original version of this was released in 1980. It was an arcade game. And the Apple... This Apple clone came out in 1981. So yeah, this is definitely a... Definitely a ripoff in this case. But also surprisingly playable. So this is Thief for the Apple II. This is a ripoff of Berserk. It sort of looks like an exploration game because you're in this maze-like room and there are other directions you can go, but there's really no exploration. Once you go through a door, that door is sealed off and you can no longer, you know, I can't go back into the previous room. And it doesn't actually matter which direction I go because eventually I'm going to hit the blue area. And the blue area is a lot like the green area, except that the enemies here will actually fight back. You can see that guy trying to shoot me over there. And if you wait too long, the happy smiling face of death comes along and tries to destroy everything on the screen. And in Berserk, that guy is called Evil Otto. I don't know if he has a name in Thief. You know, when I played this, I had no idea that Berserk was a thing. You know, I had no frame of reference. I thought this was an original game, so I can't hate it based on that. It does eventually get extremely hard. The enemies don't really do much for the first couple areas of the game. Also, you don't have to kill every enemy on the screen to proceed. But this is a score-based game, so I guess if you want that sweet bonus score, you want to try to clear as many rooms as possible. Nope, they did not even change the happy face of death. This is a straight-up rip. Also, if I touch any of these walls, I will immediately die. So that's another threat. So once you get into the red space, things get really spicy. These guys will start shooting at you constantly. Sometimes as soon as you enter a room, you'll just immediately get shot before you have time to react. Man, that guy in the middle is just not meant for this world, I guess. By the way, to shoot... Oh, I got an extra life. Nice. To shoot, you hold down the button and you use the joystick to shoot. Which was pretty good for the time. It feels surprisingly natural and not bad to shoot stuff that way. The Robotron version for the Apple II also uses the same hold the button to shoot, but it's a little harder to do that in Robotron just because there are so many more enemies on the screen. I think Robotron did have a really convoluted 8-way keyboard control setup. Yeah, once you have a lot of stuff on the screen, things start slowing down considerably. I don't think there's anything after red. I think once you hit the red rooms, you just kind of keep going until you die. Also very satisfying sound effects in this game. I'll let you live. Oh my god. I don't think I've ever seen purple. I can barely move. There's so much crap flying on the screen. Holy crap. Look at that slowdown. Oh, the enemies can shoot each other as well, which is nice. I forgot about that feature. I feel like I should be getting higher bonus scores in the more difficult areas. God, this is janky. Okay, well, I got the high score. Alright, that's enough action for now. Let's do something to exercise my brain. So this is a game that I didn't own until one of my junior high classes had a collection of Apple II discs. And this was among them. You know, mostly it was just stuff mostly at school just had stuff I already had. You know, they had Oregon Trail and Number Munchers and all that stuff. But they actually had a retail copy of this game, so I asked the teacher if I could borrow it, and I brought it home and I made a copy for myself. Which, since I only had one disk drive, that was a very involved process. You had to put the disk in, let it read a few kilobytes of data, and then put in the blank disk so it could write it, and you would have to do that a few times. I forget exactly how many, but it was probably, it was at least 10. And this was a two-sided disk, so just swapping the disk in and out a whole bunch of times. But I got a free game out of it, so I'm not complaining. Am I a returning champion? No. I will be a gentleman. Would I like a different character? Yes. I think I'll be Leslie Nielsen. I could be Michael J. Fox. This isn't a person. And this is a person, but I don't know who. I'll be Leslie Nielsen. I did copy that floppy. But, you know, this was 1997 or 1998. This was decades after this game was even available for sale, so I didn't feel bad about it. So I will be playing with Gracie and Theodore. My buzzer will be the space bar. To reset the controls, press 5 to reset during play. Oh, so I can reset the controls now with 5, or press Control C during play to reset. Very intuitive. But yeah, you can play 3 people on the same keyboard with this, which was pretty cool. No, I don't have a question disc. Oh, I get to choose, huh? Let's see. Not too happy with most of these categories. I'll go with geology. It's probably my strongest subject here. Oh, I know that. So, you have to actually use the full question format. So, what is lava? And I like that you can just immediately buzz in. You don't have to wait for a timer. You might have to do that in multiplayer games. These, not Paul Bunyan, carved the Great Lakes. I mean, it has to be rivers, right? What? What else would carve something out of the land? Erosion? I mean, that's a symbol. Glaciers. Oh, interesting. I did not know that. Well, that'll teach me to guess. Or that'll teach me not to guess. What is / R? Fossils. I don't think it actually matters which question format you use. I don't think it would count me wrong if I used the wrong grammar. What skyscrapers rest on, or where the Flintstones lived. I think they mean skyscrapers. Who were bedrock? Yeah, what is bedrock? So it doesn't actually care about your grammar. Place where meeting of the Pacific Plate and the North American Plate has caused a lot of tension. Oh, wait. I was just going to say tectonic plates, but do they want a specific one? Oh, shoot. Oh, thank God. That would have been a very costly mistake if I didn't think of that. I don't know what flight's fancy is. Oh, man. Boy, these computer players suck. Weather condition that took Dorothy to Oz. Yeah, this was much better than the game console versions of Jeopardy because you can actually type your answer in instead of having to use a game controller to move from letter to letter. So, if you're going to play a version of Jeopardy, this is a pretty good one. I also had Jeopardy on the Sega CD, which had... Oh, Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. Spine. Oh, man. Is it the James Bond guy? Yeah, Ian Fleming. Oh, well. I don't know what category she chose. His common sense annoyed the British. Thomas Paine. Oh, yeah. I like how they just jump straight for the $500 question. Hitler endorsed this German auto. Oh. Always love a good Hitler question. Let's finish out Flight Fancy. Or Flights of Fancy. Oh, winged creature. The Griffin. It's been too long since I've read Through the Looking Glass. I read Alice in Wonderland relatively recently. The Stivix? What? I didn't get to read the full question. The Stivix lived with her parents in the series. No idea. I don't even know what that means. Yeah, this is going to be a bunch of 70s and 80s. The 80s sitcoms that I don't know anything about. Okay, this is George did it. Let's see what this category is about. Pygmalion and Major Barbara. Well, never would have gotten that. Alright, more 76 stuff. Our countries, you know, just assuming that I'm an American. I guess I'll go with the George category. Who kissed the girls and made them cry? Oh man, I don't know the spelling of this. I hope it's forgiving. Okay, good. So, it does allow a little leeway there for things that most people probably don't know how to spell. 1972 presidential candidate. Was that Nixon? No. Jeopardy. Oh, it doesn't air outside the U.S., really? George McGovern. I know the name now that I read it. I'm glad I didn't guess Nixon. That probably would have been a very bad guess. Wait. Sportscaster, former Miss America, named George, and wife of ex-governor of Kentucky. No idea. Oh, George is her last name. Well, I guess I don't know that much about George's. No idea. Chief choreographer of Stravinsky's ballets. No clue. George Balanchine? Yeah, never would have gotten that. Let's go car crazy. I don't know that much about cars. The A-Team's BA. Oh, I know what this is. The A-Team's B.A. Baracus would approve of this early Ford 10 Lizzie. That would be the Model T. Because B.A. Baracus was Mr. T. Spielberg's Devilish Little Gnomes. Oh, that would be the Gremlin. Yeah, I got a lot of entertainment out of this game. Like, I was talking earlier about how when you find a game that has more than 15 minutes of entertainment, you kind of treasure it. This was one of those for me, because there are quite a few questions. General Lee. So, and you know, I always loved trivia. I was never a fan of Jeopardy as a kid, just because... This luxury car's hood ornament is a legendary sword. The Excalibur. Yeah, when I was a kid, Jeopardy was too hard for me. This was a little bit easier. Although it still has regretful school teacher hung as a spy. Never heard of him. I mean, that has to be a taxi, right? Wait, no, the Honeymooners. See, I was thinking of the sitcom Taxi, which has nothing to do with the Honeymooners. So I'm gonna go bus. Okay. That seemed like a better guess, since the Honeymooners is a much older show. He gave his weekly report to Orson. I like how fast this game is. It's very snappy. I don't know what this is. Mork and Mindy. Oh, well. Never watched that show. You do have to be a fast reader for this. The computer can buzz in pretty quickly. But it's okay. I can keep up. Oh, I know this one. And the sad thing is, I only know this one because of a milk commercial. History is not my strong subject. Oh, that's the Boston Tea Party. Yeah, that bit about them being feathered kind of threw me off. I don't know what they meant by that. Wally Cox, no idea. I see 50s and I think Leave It to Beaver, because that's the only 1950s show I know about. But it's probably not that. Mr. Peepers, never heard of it. Well, I think I have a bit of a lead over Gracie and Theodore here. So, let's move on to Double Jeopardy. Ooh, Disney cartoons. Rock music. Nice. Argentina. I don't know a lot about Argentina. This probably won't be a good category for me. The Andes. I mean, I've heard of the Andes. I had no idea they were close to Argentina. Yes! Nope. Steamboat Willie. I don't know who Willie was, but starred Mickey Mouse. Let's stick with Disney cartoons. Oh, this has to be Sleeping Beauty. I didn't know her name was Princess Aurora. Wish to be a royal boy was granted by yes, the blue fairy. The Wicked Queen. Oh. Yes, Maleficent. It was on the tip of my tongue. Oh well. Oh no. Yes, okay, never mind. I promise I didn't just look it up. Well, I had to look it up in my brain. I thought it was crocodiles, but I second guessed myself. Let's go with rock music. I mean, it'll be a bunch of old rock music, but... What? This famous hymn? That's not rock music. Rock of Ages. Oh, is rock going to be in the title of all of the answers? This lament about a lonely astronaut. I don't know a lot of Elton John. Oh, Rocket Man, of course. See, if they had said Bill Shatner, then I would have gotten that one for sure. Snakes that crush their prey. That would be... Constrictor. I think I'm spelling that right. Nice. In the Garden of Eden by Iron Butterfly. That's my favorite hymn. Solid hit single for Simon and Garfunkel. Or is that Stolid? I'm a Rock, yes. Oh, this is going to be one of those categories that as soon as I see the answer, I slap myself and I think, of course. I love rock and roll. Or rock n roll. Rock and or roll. Arboreal infants. That is a very interesting way of saying that. Let's see. I guess I'll stick with reptiles. I know some of these. I'm going to have so much money that I won't even have to wager anything. Because I'm guaranteed to win. Changeable reptile. That would be Karma Chameleon. What is chameleon? What are chameleon? Oh, this has to be the Komodo dragon, right? I didn't know it was Indonesian. I'm gonna go with it. Or is it the Gila monster? Shit. Oh, thank God. Okay. Well, let's see what Oops is all about. Ooh. Alright, I'm gonna be conservative here because I'm privileged to be. I'll bet 2,000. Wait, there was no daily double in the first round. I thought there was supposed to be one daily double in round one, and then two in round two. Little Bighorn Blunder. Little Bighorn Blunder. I don't know. Man, I should have seen what this category was about before I bet anything. Is oops in the name of the answer? I don't see how it could be. Custer's Last Stand. Oh well. My character just has a heart attack when he gets it wrong. I forgot about that. Okay. Oh well, no biggie. I lost a couple $1,000, but I'm still in a commanding lead. Oh, well, darn, I should have wagered more. So this is just about famous mistakes of the past, which makes sense. Oh, Spruce Goose wasn't the actual name of the airplane, though. Was it the Hercules? It'll probably accept Spruce Goose, right? Okay. I wonder what would have happened if I typed in the actual name of the plane. $1 million Western Epic. I feel like I should know this. I don't know who Michael Cimino is, though. Oh, no clue what that is. Interesting. Alright, I'm a song from the 60s. Skinny fashion model with painted on eyelashes. Twiggy. Oh. That rings some sort of vague bell in my memory banks. Oh, more Argentina. Capital and largest city in Argentina. Buenos Aires. Oh, yeah. Traditional Argentinian cowboy? Yeah, no idea. I'm sorry, Argentina. I know you're cool. JFK's name for his administration. I didn't know he had a name for his administration. Frontier. That sounds vaguely familiar. Oh, that's probably beef, isn't it? Yeah. Alright. The last one about Argentina has to be about silver, right? That's literally the only fact I know. Nope. Fertile plain that covers one-fifth of Argentina. Yeah, the only thing I know about Argentina is that it was named that because it has a lot of silver. Because the Latin name for silver is something. That's why its element is Ag. But they didn't ask that. That must be too obvious. The hula hoop. You know, for kids. Oh, yeah, I know this one. I didn't know he was a Harvard professor. Oh, I'm sorry. Dr. Timothy Leary. Lead singer of Big Brother. What? Oh. I did not know she was in a band. Alright, here we go. Final Jeopardy. Each player takes a turn entering their wager in question. Other players should not look at the screen until their own turn. Afterwards, all wagers and questions are shown and the winner is determined. The Final Jeopardy category is Conquerors. Depress any key when ready. Aw. The keys don't deserve to be depressed. Well, I feel like this is either one that I'm going to instantly know or one that I will never have heard of. But I have $11,000. So the most someone can have is $2,600 if they manage to double all of their money. So I will wager $8,000. That's how confident I am. Dictator who ordered the invasion of Ethiopia on November 3rd, 1935. The invasion of Ethiopia. Okay. No help from the audience. 1935. I feel... This is a guess. Benito Mussolini. Oh well. Well, at least Gracie and Theodore didn't get it either. Well, I made number two on the leaderboards. I would have been number one if I just didn't bet anything. Oh well, this has been Jeopardy, and this has been a stream. Thank all of you for watching. I'm sorry that we were having some issues. I'm probably going to have to start just streaming on Twitch, because I've been having so many issues with YouTube lately. Although CPC Gamer was saying that even on Twitch, he was getting some buffering as well, so... I don't know what to do. I don't know if it's my connection or if it's my streaming setup or what, but I'll probably try to simplify things next time and see if that helps, because I'm also getting a lot of lag between me and the chat. That's why I haven't really been responding to you, CPC Gamer. Sorry about that. But thank all of you for watching, and thank all of you who are watching the archive. This has been a pleasure, and I have plenty more Apple II games to play and talk about, so there will be another one of these sometime soonish, and there will be more Creepy Castle and more Dragon Warrior 7 and more Limelight. I haven't forgotten about Limelight. But yeah, thank you all so much. It's been a blast. Take care of yourselves and each other. Duke of the Bump, signing off.